I wasn't particularly sure why I was invited by the organizers to this session, because I was a bit worried. I'm not a science, I do have a science background, I'm a medical person by background, I'm not a technologist. So I thought I would just speak to you on the basis of some experience that I've had as a practitioner, but more so as a policy advocate on issues related to nutrition, wherein I've encountered scientists and technologists in a particular paradigm and frame. And that has given rise to a certain, some questions, and perhaps also one or two small submissions and propositions that I would like to leave for you. Some of my work has been made really very much easier by the presentations that have preceded me, but also they've also left me a bit overwhelmed. You know, I'm a little confused as to the whole scope and spectrum of things. For example, the complexity of, you know, we're now getting into the domain of applications, practice, practitioners, how to make things happen in real life. And that, I think Lina brought it out very clearly, is a very, very complex domain. And very often we're caught between the devil and the deep blue sea, not able to move forward, not able to move backward, many, many different forces upon us, not clear what the correct direction is. So it's in that scenario that policies are developed in any given context. Now, during my interaction with science and technology people, I realized that they have a great deal of power. And that power is very similar to the power that a medical practitioner has, in that they're saying something that is technically complex and that not everybody can understand, and therefore it is extremely difficult also to challenge what this expert is saying in the situation, in the context of a policy forum or a committee room where he or she is addressing a government representative who's going to go on, take that advice and make policies for the entire country. Very difficult to challenge unless you belong to the same discipline and bring that discipline to the same sector of expertise. And if somebody deigns to challenge it from the outside, it's also very risky for the person who's trying to do so. Now, so what is this power, and then what are the limitations of that power, and how should we wield that power as scientists and technologists within the context of a policy situation where we are expected to give advice basically to government? And are technologists and scientists aware of this power that they wield and they control? I mean, for example, if I were to ask myself as a medical practitioner, is it the domain of medicine that holds the answer to the difficulties of health for all? I'd say no. I would say no. Does that mean that I don't believe in the practice of medicine or the you know, need for medicine? No, not at all. So similarly, if I were to ask people who are involved in science and technology, that is it in the domain of science and technology that the answer lies to why we have not achieved health for all in this country in particular? I don't know how many of you would be able to say yes or no to that. But we know, I think all of us know, that there are enough fruits and tools that technology has delivered in the world. There's no dearth of technological advance. And yet we're in a situation where these have not at all translated into things. So there is an issue of this differential, and there's this issue of power. Now, before moving on, I just want to explain a little bit about the nutrition situation in India, and then bring in the context of then what should be the role of scientists and technologists, and what is it that I'm trying to prescribe and how we should go about our business. We know, let me just focus on child malnutrition, because that has been occupying us for quite some time as a country, as a public health problem of a very large domain. So amongst, say, children under the age of 6, we would be talking to the scale of something like 60 million children under the age of 6 who are malnourished. And this forms the entire foundation of all their rights, their role as society, their future, their education, their ability to labor, etc., etc. So it's a very, very important issue. But more than that, so 60 million children under 6 with malnutrition. We have a scheme, for example, in the country for this, which is called the ICDS, you may be aware of that. And we are talking about 14 lakh centers in the country. Then all told, if we look at village level health volunteers who are to impact this, we're talking about something like 30 lakh women volunteers at village level. And if we think each child, 5 rupees per child per day, we're talking of a market that is something like 30 crores a day of guaranteed investments from the public exchequer. So this is the domain. This is the domain of the market. I mean, other speakers before me have also referred to supply side pressures. This is the domain of the market. And it's a small wonder that the industry called the nutraceutical industry is following hard on the heels of the pharmaceutical industry. I don't know, maybe yesterday there's been much more detail on the politics of the pharmaceutical industry and the push and pulls within it. Some of it we heard this morning also. So if we don't realize it as scientists and technologists, they certainly do. I mean, I can just quote the head of the business at Nestle saying there is a race to the middle between pharma and food. The opportunity is big, the risk is big, the reward is big. So all the problems that we have encountered in the pharmaceutical industry, we are open to encounter in the nutraceutical industry. Now, within this now framework, we are talking of policy debates and discussions. Now, what happens is, when say a scientist is asked a question, which is going to lead to policy. For example, I'll take a simple example. This bottle of water. Now, this is a Kingfisher Premium packaged drinking water. It could have been Bisleri. Well, let me just use the word Bisleri because we understand. Suppose somebody, I am an expert on safe water. I'm a scientist. I'm a technologist. Somebody asks me, what is the problem with this product? If I say there is no problem with this product, am I lying? I'm not lying. But is that sufficient as an answer? I mean, somewhere even the scientist who's saying there is no problem with the product in this bottle as a scientist is not lying, but it's not a complete or to my mind a completely honest answer. I mean, a senior scientist who's going in as a policy advocate, as an expert on technology, it would be lazy, cowardly, perhaps even dishonest to stop and put a full stop and say there is nothing wrong with this product. So somebody, a scientist who's saying there's nothing wrong with this product, may go a little further and say, but sir, it's a bit expensive. No. Then there would be somebody across the table saying, well, we are a donor agency, we are a partner agency, we are a developmental partner. We know that India is suffering from the issue of not having enough safe water. It's a very important issue. It's a very important public health issue. Who can disown that issue? It's very important. We will find the money. We will find the money, we will buy these bottles and we will distribute these to poor people so that they do not suffer from malnutrition, they do not suffer from diarrhea, etc., etc. They are burden of reduce. Then what will the scientists say to them? Now the problem of cost has also been kind of offset. Now my submission is that this is an inadequate cost-benefit analysis by the scientists also. And what it requires is, obviously the answer doesn't lie only in the logic of what this product or the production cost of this product are. This product has to be applied in a set of, in a social context, in a socio-economic context upon people and upon communities. So have we bothered to do a cost, a social analysis and a cost-benefit analysis on those grounds? If we were to do that, what would the scientist answer? He would say there's nothing wrong with this product, sir, as a product, but in the given context, as we understand it, of this country and the people we are talking about, maybe we should invest in a technology, and here I'm borrowing from Professor Pandey, which will be how to use solar purification of a water reservoir at village level. We understand there's a higher capital cost. We understand there's a higher investment in terms of transfer of technology and decentralization. But in the long term, this is the way in which it's going to benefit us, because the cost of applying this strategy, this technological strategy, would mean a disinvestment in making tap water safe, in a disinvestment which will affect the communities at large, will affect the environment. So the environmental cost will be counted, the livelihood cost will be counted, the social cost will be counted. That is the kind of complete complex analysis that one would expect even from a scientist or a technocrat who's making an advocacy for policy. So my brief submission is that to be a good scientist, it is, I think, equally important, or very, very important, especially in the context of policy advocacy, to be also a social scientist, and to learn to and to engage with doing the kind of analyses, the kind of complex cost-benefit analyses, which are required for putting a technology into practice. Now, I love science, so I feel very, very comforted by the fact that if I drop an apple from a tree in New York, or in Switzerland, or in Swaziland, or in Jharkhand, it will more or less have the same impact. I mean, it's going to fall to the ground. Some scientists may disagree with me. There will be contexts in which it doesn't happen. 2 + 2 almost always makes 4 in some way or the other. The sun rises in the morning, sets in the evening. But if you drop a technology upon a community in all these different contexts, it doesn't behave the same way. So then if we are dealing with technology, surely we also have the responsibility to study how will we understand how it's going to behave, especially in the aspects of policy advocacy. So in a nutshell, what we need is this crossover discipline. I mean, in medicine, we're lucky to have it, even though it's a stepsister. The crossover between medicine and social science is what we call public health. And it's a public health approach that I'm demanding from technology. I don't know what discipline you have which is a crossover between technology, science, and social science. But perhaps it is by this kind of interdisciplinarity that you are exerting today in this room that best it can be achieved. All I can beg for is greater respect and greater awareness, greater alertness to the fact that social science offers us and other disciplines offer us a very, very valuable kind of insight and understanding to be able to further our own selves so that we move out of labs and into people's lives and become more and more pro people as we go towards health for all. So that's all I wanted to say.
We'll open it.